Hi, everyone. This is John Pocoroba from the Boston IBD Meetup. We haven't done a general market update since September, so I thought I would do one this weekend. November 14th, 2021. As I do with all of the general market updates, I'll be covering big picture thesis, some market internals, as well as an update on the current market index. So the big picture overview at this time, I always start with this slide here, which is looking at the concept of a market supercycle. This is the 1974 to 2000 supercycle. And some interesting things about it was when we came off the 1974 bear market bottom, the market ground its way higher for about 10 years. And everybody said, how could the market go higher? It had already gone up for 183% gains. But it was right in this yellow orange box that the baby boomers became a catalyst. They were entering their peak years of consumption in the early 80s, 82, 83, 84, and it led to a super cycle, which was actually an 814% gain in 16 years. So you can see from 84 all the way to the top in 2000. Now there were bear markets along the way. In 1987 crash, 1990 bear market, and also the 1998 bear market. I use this as a precedent for what I call is the current super cycle. We used the 2009 bear market bottom, and we basically, similar to the 1974 bottom, we went up 350% in 10 years. And many people said we can't possibly go any higher. Well, that orange box is another significant catalyst demographically for the market, as there's 84 million millennials that are entering their peak consumption years. And it started in the 2019 range. So what's important is if you forecast potentially a super cycle could last 25 years with this kind of demographic driver. Of course, there's going to be bear markets along the way. We had the 2018 bear market and recently the COVID bear market. The oldest millennials turned 40 in 2021. And it still leaves almost a 15-year window for millennials to enter their peak consumption years, buying houses, cars, insurance, financial services. At the same time, we have the boomers that are retiring, second homes, transfer of wealth to millennials, healthcare. So there's a lot of demographic drivers that potentially could keep a super cycle in place for quite a while. This slide here was taken from the December 2020 IBD meetup. And I tried to look at a comparison. We had just come off the bear market in March of 2020, which was a 32% correction. And I compared that market to the NASDAQ sharp correction in 1998, which was a 33% decline. What was interesting is the first initial run-up off the bottom from the COVID lows ran up approximately 82% off the bottom. And it had three corrections. Very similarly, the 1998 bear market rose approximately 86% off the bottom and had a 12% correction. And we used this last year and we said, well, what happened next? Well, the 98 market, as it moved into 1999 was a very choppy market, but it had an upward bias, an upward tilt. And the strongest gains in 1999 from this blue box were made in the last 2 months of 99. And of course, that was the beginning of the incredible rally to the top in 2000. So I took this slide and I basically have updated to say, where are we relative to this potential precedent? So we look at it now, and we mentioned the 1999 period was a choppy upward tilt. Here we are today. This is 2021, which interestingly enough has a choppy market for 2021, but it again has an upward tilt. And as we all know, in the last month, the market is starting to move again. It's moving higher. And you'll notice the volume is picking up. Could this lead to something that happened back in 2000? Nobody knows. Take it day by day. But I thought it was still an interesting comparison that was still holding up as of today. So let's look at some of the market internals. I try to keep the market internals fairly simplistic, not look at too many things. One of the things that I do use is the New York advanced decline line. In a very simplistic way, when the S&P indexes, which is this black line, moves into new highs, we want to see the advanced decline line also move to new highs. That is confirmation that the new high of the index is confirmed by new highs by the stocks within the index. So that's a very positive confirmation right now with the advanced decline line. I also look at the number of new highs every day minus the number of new lows every day to get a net number. And these charts show the net new highs or new lows. So the NASDAQ is on the left and the S&P on the right. You'll notice in the NASDAQ, since this rally began in October, we've had some really nice spikes of new highs that we haven't seen since way back in March when the market was peaking. So this is a good sign that as the market, the index is moving to new highs, we're starting to see the new highs list, net new highs get stronger. Similarly on the S&P, it's definitely an upward bias as we build this rally. So that's all still fairly constructive at this point. So if we look at the S&P, specifically plotting the number of new highs, very similar to the advanced decline line, when the market moves to new highs, we want to see the net new highs also confirm that action. The peak back in early September, there were 251 new highs on the S&P. When we finally broke out to new highs in the third week of October, we had 212 new highs. So not exactly what we wanted to see, but we wanted to see if it was going to kick in. And you'll notice that by early November, as the market really pushed higher, we now had 266 new highs in the S&P. So that, again, is a positive picture. Same analysis here with the NASDAQ. The NASDAQ in early September had 248 new highs. When it broke out in late October, 192 was okay, but it had not exceeded the 248. But since then, the last 2 weeks, the market's moved up. We've got 357 new highs, net new highs, which again, is a very positive picture at this stage. Now, inflation seems to be on everyone's minds. There's inflation worries, and the market is trying to sort out, is inflation going to be short-term and transitory, as the Fed has portrayed, or is there a real concern that inflation will be long-term and not controllable? So one of the things you can look at is, I've taken the XLK ETF, which is the technology ETF, and divided it by the value stock ETF, the Vanguard value ETF. So you'll notice that when the line is moving up, that means the technology index is outperforming value. So you'll notice throughout 2019 and 2020, tech was really outperforming value. Now, since last September, October, as the market kind of started to move higher, but at a slower pace, you can see in this red box, the line is moving down, which means value stocks are outperforming the tech index. Now, if the market was really worried about inflation being long-term and uncontrollable, you would see value stocks really come into vogue. The cyclical names, the defensive names, the value names would all start to outperform. So here's what we have right now. Since May, July, you'll notice that tech has started to again outperform the value index as we're moving to new highs. So it's a situation where tech would not be outperforming if the market was really worried about longer term inflation. Now that can change at any moment, but right now the market seems to be believing the Fed's message that it's transitory. So let's quickly look at the current market analysis. And I wanted to talk about some seasonality. This is a chart by LPL Research, and it's just showing you that November is historically a very, very strong month for the market. These black bars are the performance since 1950. The blue bar is the last 20 years in November. oranges the last 10 years in November, and even post-election years represented by the dark gray bar. So we're in a very seasonally strong period for the market. November, December, and January are typically the strongest 3 months of the year. So we have that kind of tailwind behind us right now. Again, this is a chart again from LPL Research. And I took this slide from the May 20th, 2021 IBD meetup. This is representing three different markets. The dark blue line here represents the current market from March 2020 when the bull market began to at this time of the chart, we were 1 month into it. And we compared that to the green line, which is the March 09 bottom. And you can see how they tracked fairly closely where they actually peaked. After year one, the market peaked, and you'll see the green line went through a period of underperformance, drifted downward until it got to about the last quarter of the year, and then the market really took off again. And the gray line is the 1982 bull market through 1987. And you'll notice that that bull market peaked a little less than 1 year and then went basically sideways, trended down most of the rest of the year, then turned up strong at the end of the year. And back in May of 2021, I had said, who knows, is this what, have we peaked? And, you know, we talked about if this was really the peak for our market, which happened to be January, February, March timeframe. And we said, if this script were to follow through, we're probably gonna go through a choppy summer. And we said, maybe we could turn up in the fall. We seem to be at, as of November 1st, we're probably somewhere around here where the market kind of bottomed and we're starting to rally. So whether this continues or not, no predictions here, but I think it's an interesting observation looking at a couple of really strong bull markets in 82 and 09. So I wanted to get to the end of this looking at the NASDAQ composite, which is on the screen. And keeping this again fairly simple, you know, we had a nice strong rally since early October to early November. And the breakout was accompanied by a nice increase in above average volume by these represented by these big blue spikes. So very nice strong rally. You'll notice in the last week or two, we're getting a little bit of a pullback, which would be really, really normal action in the market. This is the red box. You know, we could come all the way back down and touch out the breakout level possibly and kiss it. That would be very normal and not to be unexpected. Many people are saying that the market is really overbought. There's a lot of overbought indicators. So we have to come back down. And I would say, well, maybe we come back down. We certainly could come back down and have a normal pullback. But, you know, one of the most bullish things a market can do, it will stay overbought. And this usually happens at the beginning of a bull move, particularly after bear markets. You will see when you get the follow through a day after a bear market, you'll get a surge, the market will become overbought, and it will stay overbought because people don't believe the rally. And sometimes the market will not pull back and create what we call a lockout rally, where everybody who missed that rally wants the market to come back so they can actually initiate some positions. And many times the market will just not accommodate them. There'll be shorter pullbacks and continue higher. We don't know how this is gonna go. Today's action was a little bit mixed on the 15th of November, but we'll take it day by day. It's important not to make predictions or label the market. Again, take it day by day. What is the price and volume of the leading stocks doing? As well as what are the major averages are doing. If you're an IBD follower, and if you've attended market school, the power trend is in an on condition, which essentially means we've been trending above the 21-day moving average, which is this pink line on my chart. So we've been above that for quite a while in the rally, and the power trend is on, which is a very positive signal. We have only had one distribution day on the NASDAQ, and one stall day. We only get really concerned when we have four, five, six distribution days clustered within a 30-day period. So again, this is a very positive picture. We're not being swamped with distribution yet. So in keeping it really simple, the market, you know, definitely could pull back here. It would be normal. If the market were to come and break the breakout level and come all the way back to the 50, then I would get very defensive because something might be wrong with this rally and maybe it was a fake out. But we'll have to see how it plays out. But just don't make predictions. Just take it day by day and try to interpret. So the Boston meetup hasn't had a formal meeting in a couple of months. We will be reconvening in December. I'll be speaking on strategies for earnings seasons. As we all know, earnings seasons can be quite volatile, and it's always a great place where people ask lots of questions about how to handle their positions and how to handle a very volatile potential time. So I'll be covering 4 to 5 different strategies you can consider in your trading, and hopefully can glean some pieces of information that you can apply in the January time period when we go through the next earnings season. So hopefully it's a timely webinar. We'll be sending out reminders in early December, but I wanted you to be aware that it was coming up. So thanks again for joining this general market update from the Boston IBD meetup. I'm John Pokoroba, and I'll see you in December.